Am I live?
Yes.
Oh my God, I'm live? Seriously? Okay. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وقال نسوة في المدينة امرأة العزيز تراود فتاها عن نفسه قد شغفها حبا إنا لنراها في ضلال مبين. فلما سمعت بمكرهن أرسلت إليهن وأعتدت لهن متكئا وآتت كل واحدة منهن سكينا وقالت اخرج عليهن فلما رأينه أكبرنه وقطعن أيديهن وقلن حاش لله ما هذا بشرا إن هذا إلا ملك كريم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, once again everyone, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Today I attempt to cover ayah number 30. And maybe we move on to 31. I think I numbered them incorrectly in the title, but 30 and 31 is what I'm going to try to get to. Yesterday we covered up until ayah number 29. And now the scene is changing. The last thing we talked about was the confrontation that happened right at the door and how the matter was resolved and how the politician, the minister, Al-Aziz, tried to put everybody in place and kind of quell the issue before it becomes, it spills out. But it seems that the word got out. It seems that people went home and they started talking about it. This was an incident that took place. And this is actually, in a strange sense, kind of a parallel to what happens in the story of Musa alayhi salam and the Pharaoh. Yet another subtle parallel. And that is that the first confrontation that happened between him and Musa alayhi salam was inside the walls of the castle and the palace. And the confrontation that happened with the snake finally coming out and all of it was an embarrassment to the Pharaoh, and he wanted to keep that contained. But actually word got out and it turned into a pretty big problem, and it became a PR problem for him. Similarly here, you've got this politician who's hoping to keep this domestic issue contained, but he wasn't able to. And so as I read a base translation of the coming ayah for you, it would go as follows. وَقَالَ نِسْوَةٌ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ, and some women in the city said, إِمْرَأَةُ الْعَزِيزِ تُرَاوِدُ فَتَاهَا عَنْ نَفْسِهِ, the wife of the minister is trying to seduce her servant boy for her, servant boy. قَدْ شَغَفَهَا حُبَّ, he has penetrated through the layers of her heart with love. إِنَّا لَنَرَاهَا فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ, we absolutely see her as someone lost in delusion or confusion, obviously. So this is now, the ayah is dedicated to what women were saying. So there's a few things here that we want to kind of address. The first of those things is qala niswatun. Usually in Arabic, those of you that study basic Arabic grammar know this is a jumla fi'liya, a verb-based sentence. And here, the word qala seems unusual at first glance because you're expecting to hear qalat niswatun. Qalat would be corresponding to the fa'il, the subject of the sentence, which is also feminine. So qalat niswatun would be a much easier way to process, but qala niswatun comes across as, wait, what just happened here? This should match in gender. The two should match in gender. The first response to that is, niswatun can be considered a group, like an ism jama', and with an ism jama', the equivalent of that in English can be something like collective nouns, but not entirely. But when in Arabic a group is being referred to, or they're being talked about as a single unit or as a single group, then you can use the masculine for them regardless of their gender. So in that case, you can here actually say qala, and it's completely grammatically sound. Now, despite having said that, there are still speculation about why would qala be used for niswatun. Why would the masculine be used anyway? You can use the feminine too. So it seems going out of one's way to use the Allah is deliberately using the masculine where the feminine was expected. And one, postulated theory is they weren't acting very women-like when they were doing this, and therefore the masculine, which Sheikh Suhaib in his discussion actually completely rejects. And I think that, I used to think that way, but I think that argument's rather weak also. Dr. Fadl Salih Hassamirai, in his explanation of sentence structure, and he's a remarkable scholar of grammar, and he's written a book very different than other books on Arabic grammar. His work on Ma'ani al-Nahu, the deeper meanings of grammar. So he's trying to understand the rhetorical function of grammatical structures in Arabic, in classical Arabic language. He has a particular theory. His theory is when there's a gender mismatch, a deliberate gender mismatch, then you go back to a larger principle. And the larger principle is that the masculine is inclusive and the feminine is exclusive. So that sounds geeky, but let me put that in simple words. What that means is if the masculine is being used here, perhaps predominantly women were the ones talking, but it's not they were the only ones talking. So that would be one way of looking at qala niswatun. Because the masculine is ashmal, it includes more. So it's maybe a subtle rhetorical way of saying, yes, women were talking, but they weren't the only ones. And the ones that aren't being mentioned, but still not entirely off the hook, may have been captured inside of the qala as opposed to the qalat. Again, this is not conclusive, but that is one possible way if you were to take Dr. Samir Rai's approach to it. I would also say that it's probably implausible to think that only women were talking. That's probably impossible. It's the servants that were there, some of them were male, some of them were female, for example, right? And they went home and spoke to their families, kids, spouses, whatever. So both genders are talking in some respects. But here, the primary emphasis, doesn't matter who else was talking. There's a particular group that is more important for the development of the next scene and what's going to be explained. Is not just people in general were talking, a specific group was talking. I'm almost reminded of the rumor that was spread about Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha and how everybody was talking, yeah? Because it just became a popular subject. And I would imagine this became a popular subject. So everybody's talking. And there in the hadith in Bukhari, وَالنَّاسُ يُفِيضُونَ فِي قَوْلِ أَصْحَابِ الْإِفْكِ, people were just diving into the words that the slanderers had started. So she used the word people when she was describing the scene, right? But by contrast here, we're not finding that Allah is saying people were talking. He's saying a specific group, niswatun, which is one of the particular forms of a plural for women. It seems to suggest there's a particular brand of women, a particular type of women, or a particular social circle of women that's being talked about. And that will become clear by context also. There are two context clues. One, هذا من كيدي كنا. This is the kind of scheming you women do. Right, so you women, I told you, refers to a particular social circle, right? Then here, there's a second context clue, which is niswatun fil madinati. Niswatun fil madinati, women in the city. And the phrase in the city seems like a, you know, superfluous addition. Even if you don't say it, you could say women were talking. But why women in the city? It's almost as if the ayah is saying city women were talking, meaning higher ups, uptown people. You know, deluxe apartment in the sky, that sort of thing, you know. So they're the women that are in the upper echelon, the city folk, the women from that group, the civilized society, if you will, the elite, if you will, their women were starting to talk. So they have a, you know, I told you, they may greet each other with smiles and, you know, dress up and be at each other's parties and things like that, but they have deep-seated animosity towards each other. And the way they attack each other is not like they go at each other with fist fights and things like that. They go at each other with jabs, with scandals, with things that they can tear somebody else's reputation down without any blemishes coming on them. And finally, something's leaked about one of these women that everybody else's eyes are on. Now, why are their eyes on her? I'll get ahead of myself and then reverse. Their first words are going to be Imra'atul Aziz, the wife of the minister, Al-Aziz. Al-Aziz is basically in Arabic, it's in its origin, there are three themes to understand the word Aziz. Of course, it's one of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. One of its implications is something rare or nothing else is like it. So when someone's in a position where no one else can be in that position, so kind of a rare nudra, if you will, that's actually from the meanings of Azza. So when someone's in a rare, unprecedented position and nobody else can be in that position, that's actually part of the meaning of Al-Aziz, and that's understandable why that's one of Allah's names. That Allah is in a position, no one else could be in that position. Okay. Another implication along with that is يَغْلِبُ وَلَا يُغْلَبُ or يَعْلُو وَلَا يُعْلَى عَلَيْهِ. The one who overpowers or dominates has authority and there's no authority over him. The one who you can overpower but none can overpower him is within the meaning of Al-Aziz, and that's why it started even for people when it's used. It's used for people that have kind of a high authority and nobody can put them in check. They can put people in check, nobody can put them in the check. So, for example, the head of the hospital would be the Aziz of the hospital, kind of thing. Because he can fire people and nobody's going to fire him. You understand? Or the owner of the business could be the Aziz of the business because he can make all the decisions, but nobody can impose decisions on him. Now, if you keep going in small circles, you can have Aziz, then a larger circle, you have some kind of Aziz. When you get to the very top, you get Al-Aziz in the country. Al-Aziz in the country would be the one that is in a ministerial, you know, governmental kind of position where he makes some pretty executive decisions and nobody can question his decision. But I'm sure there's even someone above him, and above him is Al-Malik in the surah. There's a king above him even, right? But the king may be too involved or too lax with some, or too busy with other responsibilities, so he's handed the Aziz some execution responsibilities. Yeah, the Aziz, the word Aziz also gives us the word Izzah, which not only does it have to do with authority and the power to execute, but it also has to do with dignity. And when the Arabic language transferred to other languages, like for example, Arabic and Persian are very mixed with each other. And as Islam spread, Turkish was very deeply impacted by Arabic. And, you know, Bahasa, Indonesia and Bahasa Melayu, both Malaysian and Indonesian brands of the language are deeply impacted by the Arabic language. Hindi started mixing with Farsi, started mixing with Arabic and became Urdu. And Urdu is very deeply impacted by Arabic language. So for example, in Urdu, the word for dignity is Izzat, which is actually Izzah in Arabic, right? So these words, they travel from different cultures. When they come to a different language though, they lose some of the original meaning. Yeah, so even though I'm giving you that as a reference, that doesn't mean that every time you hear a word in Turkish and you see a similar word in Arabic, that they both mean the same thing. Because when words transfer from one language to another, some change occurs. And it may not necessarily be the same, which is why it's important to say, because so many Muslims from around the world, no matter what language you speak other than Arabic, there are probably Quran words or Arabic words that became part of your language. And when you hear those words in the Quran, you're like, I understand some of it. No, you don't. You understand that version of it that's in your language, not the Arabic word in the Quran. Right? So those two have to be kept separate. But regardless, Izzah does have to do with dignity also. So what am I getting at? The mention of Al-Aziz in the story here, the first time we're hearing his name like this, who's saying it? These women are saying it, yes? And they're saying wife of Al-Aziz. What implications are there in Al-Aziz? One, he's somehow in a governmental position, a governorship, a ministry position, whatever it is, that is unique and nobody is parallel to him. So he's in a unique, you know, supreme position of governance. Now, these women are also elite women, so their husbands may also be involved in governmental positions, but it may seem that from the word Aziz, their men are not at the position of that man, because he is Al-Aziz, so he's kind of on top. So you can already see maybe some sort of jealousy suggested, because the only way someone can be Al-Aziz, if he's Al-Aziz right now, if he's no longer in that position, then one of our husbands can possibly vie for that position. So this may be an opportunity for him to be brought down. And Aziz also means someone who commands respect. And obviously now they find a chance to tear down some of that respect. Right? So that's another implication. Then there's a sarcasm in the word authority. Al-Aziz. Al-Aziz is someone who commands authority. A man who commands authority doesn't even have authority over who? His wife? So there's a few jabs inside the use of the word Aziz. And he's a celebrity. The biblical term is, you know, Potiphar. And the Quran, the Mufassirun call him Qitfir. And these names are known to the Egyptians. They could have used the name and everybody would have known. Like today, you don't have to say the president in America. You don't have to say the president. You could say Trump, everybody will know who you're talking about, right? But when you use the word the president, you meant something by that. You were trying to get at something. So the use of his title is important in the sarcastic comment that they're making. Now, the first words they say that come out of their mouth are the wife of Al-Aziz, the wife of the minister. So now there are two individuals actually being jabbed at. Even though they're going to be talking about the wife, they've also kind of taken a jab at the minister. Now, why? But really primarily it's a jab at the wife. Okay, it's almost as if they're going to get to the wife to get to the minister, right? And so I gave you one motivation. One possible motivation can be they want to see him brought down. And maybe she's the weak link that they can use to bring him down. Or it could be that they want to make her look so bad that eventually he says, you know, she's a political liability, I want to divorce her. And then maybe one of them has a chance at it, at being his wife. So being in that position. So there could be these other subtle games that are being played here. But the point is, we need to make her look so bad that she can no longer be in that position. Right? So now, قَالَ نِسْوَةٌ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ إِمْرَأَةُ الْعَزِيزِ. So, and this terminology too, because they all know her name, right? The wife of the minister. Now, if you know someone's name and you use these words, you're already saying she's married. And for God's sakes, you're married to the minister? You don't have the sense? And of all, you don't appreciate what you have? You don't appreciate who you're with? And the embarrassment it must be to him. You're the minister's wife. All of that is inside just Imra'atul Aziz as they're sipping on their tea, ripping her to shreds. Right? Imra'atul Aziz. Then they say, Turawidu fataha an nafsihi. Now, Turawidu is actually the present tense of seduction. She wants to seduce her young servant. She wants to seduce. Not wanted. Wants. Now, this incident happened, but they're now not talking about what happened. They're talking about it as if this is going on, an ongoing thing, and they have a relationship, and she's constantly trying to seduce him and going at him. Or maybe the servants in the house, we haven't done the biblical comparison, the servants in the house have maybe now let it out that she's actually been making passes at him for a while. That this has been going on for a while. Because the Bible actually suggests that she was going at him for a while. Like she was explicit about it. Quran is not that way. But the Bible does talk about it that way. Even if we don't accept that narrative. The point here is, they are speaking as if they know something for a fact that they don't know. Okay? They're talking about something that's ongoing. It may have just stopped right at that time. I mean, she got called out. Maybe now things have cooled off and she's not going to try anything dumb again, because now the minister's on watch and he put her on alert, because you're hurting my political career now. You better not make this mistake again. Istaghfiri li dhanbiki. Innaki kunti min al-khati'een. You've made a big mistake. You're from those who make mistakes. So it may be that that's not going on, but they need to paint her a certain way, because talking about her in the present tense and talking about her as if she's the wife of the minister doing this, look at what she's doing, is they're trying to paint her as someone who is continually in this habit, or she's addicted to him, or she's obsessed with him, and she can't get over him, and she's just, you know, lost in him, etc. So they say, قَدْ شَغَفَهَا حُبَّ. Shaghaf is used in Arabic for the outer layer of the heart. The medical heart, the biological heart, the outer layer of covering of it is called a shaghaf. And the verb shaghafa actually means to pierce through it. So they're sarcastically saying, or they're actually depicting the reality of as they see it, or as they want people to see it. They're saying he's been able to penetrate through the layer, the outer layer of her heart with love. Meaning the love for him has penetrated deep inside of her. She's so obsessed with him. Now, this is as if, it's not like they're incriminating Yusuf alayhi salam. But they're saying, she's so obsessed with her servant, she sees him and he just goes right through her heart, doesn't he? Wow, she's just crazy about him. Funny, the wife of the minister, crazy about a servant. And her young servant, Fataha. And Fatah also suggests that she's older in age. That she wants her young servant, right? So she's older and she wants this young man for herself. So this is the language that they're using. It's pretty embarrassing language that they're using. And they're talking among each other. The Quran is capturing that they're not just saying this privately. This is actually something that's reverberating. People are talking. They're WhatsApping each other. They're posting memes about it. They're doing that kind of stuff. And it's just getting out and out and out and out. People are making little video blog posts about it or whatever. You know, people are chatting about it with each other, making jokes about it. And then they say, Inna lanaraha. We, in fact, we truly see her as lost. She is so lost. Inna la nara. And the lam of emphasis, or the oath, is on the nara. We see. Meaning, if you ask me, she's just gone crazy. Wow, I hate to say it, but there's no other way to look at it. She's just not right in the head. But then they don't just say she's lost. She says في ضلال مبين. Mubin could mean she's obviously lost. But mubin can have ta'addi also. And ta'addi would mean she's so lost and it's now become obvious, isn't it? It's come out that she's lost. I mean, we always thought she was a little off, but now we know, don't we? It's as if we do crazy things, but ain't nobody know because it didn't come out yet. But hers came out. Oh, too bad for her. So the idea that it's come out, it's become mubin, ibana for everybody else, right? So they're actually even mocking the fact that this wasn't contained, that it's spread out and we're all talking about it. And in it, they're actually almost entitled. They're feeling entitled to be able to say this. Now, as I paint this picture for you, I kind of already answered the question that's coming in front, coming in the next ayah. And the question is, what is their motivation for talking like this? One, it could just be entertainment. Some people love backbiting, and they love slander, and they love just tearing somebody down. A sin in private is a sin in private. And a crime against somebody, if it's been resolved, it's been resolved. And if it's brought to trial, it's brought to trial. But you talking about it is not because you're concerned about justice. Nor are you concerned about the well-being of any human being when you talk about it. All you're interested in is it's interesting conversation. It's fun to tear somebody else's dignity to shreds because it's just easy to do, you know. And so, right or wrong, and as they talk about it, think of it from Yusuf alayhi salam's point of view. We always think of, they're talking about this woman, right? Now, think of it from Yusuf alayhi salam's point of view. Yusuf alayhi salam is hearing people say that he has pierced through her heart. And he's seduced, like she's trying to seduce him as he has pierced through her heart and she's obsessed and in love with him. Is he embarrassed by what he's hearing? Is he embarrassed that he has to hear these things about himself? Yeah? He's been put in a very uncomfortable position. This isn't just talking about her. There are other ramifications. There are other implications of talking about one person because you're not just talking about them. You're talking about someone else too. And you have to understand, when people make these kinds of speculations, they don't think, oh, Yusuf alayhi salam innocent, her guilty. They're gonna take this conversation in every direction. They're gonna say, yeah, maybe he is innocent and she just went crazy over him, but maybe he, you know, something, something. It takes two, you know. Like some people will throw that out there, right? When there's smoke, there's fire. He must have done something to drive her that crazy. So they're going to throw him under the bus too without even thinking twice about it. Why would they care about the dignity of a slave? Why would they care? So the first, you know, idea here is that there is an over-speculation that is reckless, that does damage more than you realize. The second thing to note here is this is an anchor. The first time we heard somebody is truly lost and it's become obvious is when the brothers of Yusuf were talking about their father, that he loves Yusuf and his brother more. They said, "Inna abana lafi dalalim mubin." Same exact words. Our dad is absolutely lost in obvious misguidance. He's so lost, he's so clearly lost. It's become clear that he's lost. They're saying, we see him as clearly lost, exactly same words. "Inna lanaraha fi lafi dalalim mubin." And this is the Quran's way of actually making a parallel between these two scenes. The language is deliberate. And the what do we learn from connecting that quote to this quote? Like what comes out of it? What comes out of it is, they both, what do they have in common? Speculation. Those people are saying it out of jealousy. Jealousy because they want to tear Yusuf alayhi salam down. And they want to earn the love of Yaqub alayhi salam. In their mind, dad is just lost and he's clearly confused because if he wasn't confused, he would love us. Here, so there. They're speaking based on their own emotional assumptions, but the one they're talking against is actually someone they love. Like they want to earn his love in their own head. Here, these women are talking based on their assumptions against someone they hate. Right? Because they don't like this lady. They want to see her tear down. They're not vying for her love. Like those brothers were vying for the father's love. What are we learning? Your emotions don't matter. It could be you hate someone and you're doing this. It could be out of love you're thinking this. But your emotions and your feelings do not create reality and don't give you a right to make assumptions about someone you love or someone you hate. Either way is destructive. And so their words led to a larger sin. Their words led to a larger sin. On their love led them that way. And here, their words are, they have another intention. They're not just doing this because they're naive. And that's the other thing. Those brothers, at least emotionally, they're naive. They're not thinking straight. And then they come up with a diabolical plan. But the first thought process was rather unsophisticated. Dad loves him more. They could have solved that very easily. But here, these women are actually pretty sophisticated. They're smart. Niswatun fil madinati. The words they used, Imra'atul Aziz, turawidu fataha an nafsihi, qad shaghafaha hubba. All of this is meant to create an embarrassment for the minister's wife with another agenda, not just for them to get entertained, not just for them to just make an assumption and speak without thinking about it. They've thought this through. They're smart. They want her to be hurting from what's happening here. Either they want that marriage to break or they want his position to be lost. One of those two is in the agenda. And they know that this casual conversation they have is going to spread. As they have it, they're making sure that other people are listening. The servants are listening. They're talking about it in the marketplace, so the merchants are listening. They're talking about it when they're, you know, going around outside. Other people are listening. So they want this thing to spread and spread and spread and spread until it becomes viral. It becomes the talk of the town. Sorry, too soon to use the word viral. But anyway, now that this has spread and they want this teardown to happen, you can understand from that there is a scheme behind their words, yes? There's a scheme behind their words. This was a problem for Mufassireen that they tried to solve in the next ayah. And I laid this scene for you, so the next ayah, from the point of view that I'm trying to explain, becomes easier. فَلَمَّا سَمِعَتْ بِمَكْرِهِنَّ When she heard of their scheme, is the next word. When she finally heard about their scheme. And the Mufassirun started debating, what does scheme here mean? Because they're not scheming. They're just saying this, right? And what I try to tell you is, they're saying this, something is behind it. There's an outside of it, which is this commentary, this belittling commentary, but behind it is actually a political, social scheme to tear them down. And she sees it for what it is. She doesn't just say, when she heard their hurtful words, Allah didn't just quote her like that. He's saying, when she heard of their scream, or their scheme, their plot. So she understands this is part of a larger scheme. Yeah, this is a game that they're playing. And Bakr is used against an enemy, actually. Like the enemies of the deen, Allah says about them, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ They schemed, and Allah responded with His own scheme, and Allah is the best of them, of those who can respond to a scheme. وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ Right? This is in Iqas in the ayah. So now, in this ayah, when she heard of their scheme, it's not just that they did this in secret, and some people say, well, because it was done in secret, that's why it's a scheme. They want it spread. They want it out, and they want it to the point where she hears it. Because they want her to know that this is getting out there. And they want her to be on guard and be on the back foot and be nervous or anxious. And her reaction will say, ah, look at that. I would have thought it's untrue, but just look at her face. Look at her anxiety. Look at what's going on with her. Yeah, that looks like a guilty face. You see, they're trying to put her in a corner. So what does she do? أَرْسَلَتْ إِلَيْهِنَّ Literally, it means she sent towards them. It could mean she sent an invitation towards them. But in a good English translation would actually be she sent for them. She sent for them, meaning she invited them. And literally, ilayhinna, back in the old days, you didn't send somebody an email with an evite, or you didn't send somebody a WhatsApp message, come over on Thursday night or whatever. You literally sent a servant over and there's an invitation for you on Thursday night, blah, blah, blah. Right, so she set up, when she heard of their scheme, she threw them a party. That's what people do. Let's invite them over. When you're thinking of inviting someone over as a diabolical plan to get back at them or to gather intelligence, my God, the games people play. And of course, nobody ever does that anymore, right? You guys have never heard of anybody inviting someone over. This is ancient. This is not human practice anymore. You know, maybe found in some other species, not human beings. But أَرْسَلَتْ إِلَيْهِنَّ She sent for them. Okay, so she's invited them to a party. And they hate her guts, and she knows they hate her guts because she's heard what they're saying about her and the scheming. And they know what they think of her. Lost, obviously. Crazy lady. But guess what? Yeah, of course. Yeah, I'll come. All getting dressed up, all coming. And now the Mufassirun are speculating, why did they accept the invitation? Some say they accepted the invitation because maybe their scheme was they're going to talk like that because they're going to entice her to, then they knew that she was going to invite them, and when she invites them, they'll finally get to see Yusuf. Like, their scheme was to try to get to see Yusuf. I think that's too simplistic personally. I think there's a larger political agenda at play. I don't think wanting to see Yusuf alayhi salam was the big thing. It was more had to do with was the, you know, the social battle that goes on behind the scenes. So anyway, she invites them, she sends for them. وَأَعْتَدَتْ لَهُنَّ مُتَّكَأً, and she prepared for them, for those women, a muttaka. Muttaka can mean a few things. If you pronounce it mutkan, it can mean fruit, meaning she prepared fruit for them. Mutkan can, and some have also using that dialect, muttaka, and also understood it. This is found in Salaf interpretation. Meat that can be cut. But meat that you don't eat just as it is, you have to cut it. And you have to lean in on, because ittaka'a actually means to lean. So you have to lean in on the meat to cut it, to put some pressure on it, and that's why it may be called muttaka. But the general, those are somewhat rarer interpretations of the word. Muttaka also, and more generally actually, means couches or a place to sit. A muttaka can be a gathering. Like, she prepared a special room where they can just all relax and chill. Okay, well, Quran uses the, this could be the dharf, the place to sit, or couches, reclining couches. Quran uses for people in heaven, muttaki'ina ala furushin. They're going to be leaning back on cushions or beds, muttaki'ina. Right? So, muttaka'an, some place they can chill, relax, lean back. Now they have meat to cut or whatever. Maybe all of those embedded meanings if we look at them simultaneously. وَآتَتْ كُلَّ وَاحِدَةٍ مِّنْهُنَّ سِكِّينًا, and then she gave each and every one of them, one from among them, a knife. So, first thing, they're all relaxed and sitting down. Now, implied, some use the word muttaka to say they, she gave them some fruit or some meat or whatever that should be cut, and then she passed a sharp knife to each one of them. The word sikin is a word in Arabic for knife. It comes from the word sukoon, and sukoon means tranquility, calmness, right? Like in tajweed, when you learn there's a sukoon on it, you stop at it, right? A sikin was literally actually called sikin because once you slice the animal's neck, it stops moving. Like, it's the device used to bring sukoon to the animal because it kills him. Yeah, it kills the goat or the sheep or whatever. It stops them from moving, and that's why the knife is called the sikin, the tranquilizer, literally. Because it tranquilizes the animal, it makes it tranquil. Not that it puts it to sleep, but in a sense it puts it to sleep. It calms it down, its body stops moving. You know? So anyway, sikin also then suggests it's a lethally sharp knife because it's used for the killing of the animal. Right, so she gives each of one of them this knife. Now, what happens next in this scene is interpreted in different ways. And I'm sure if you've read the story before, you've maybe heard those interpretations. One interpretation classically is, and none of these are attributed to the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are human attempts to understand what really happened here. Right, so she gave them each a knife, and then she said, "Waqalat," and she said, "Ukhruj alayhinna." Come out in front of them. She said this to who? To Yusuf alayhi salam. Come out in front of them. Some of us at this point say that Yusuf alayhi salam was kept hidden in a closet in the room and he just kind of appeared. I would find that also highly implausible. After they just had a scene, we just had a scene where she tried to get him alone, I'm pretty sure he's keeping his distance from her in the house. And that's kind of the new rule in the house. But now they have, what I see far more plausible, that seems to be the apparent meaning, is there are guests over, and he's kind of, you know, shying away because he doesn't want anything to do with women, but he's still a servant, right? He's still got to do his job. So she's basically now imposing, this is not like haytalak where she's saying something inappropriate. She's saying, do your job, come out and meet the, come out and serve the guests. Ukhruj alayhinna. So now she's playing the boss role, which he can't turn down because that's his job, right? So it literally says, come out before them, come out before the women. But that's not like, I don't see that as a soft invitation. She's basically telling the servant, come out here to them. Get over here. And so she's imposing her authority on him, right? And now the scene is, these women are all leaned back. They've got this sharp knife. They've got whatever, lamb or orange or whatever they've got. And they're kind of slicing that orange and talking, I wonder if we're going to see him. And she just calls out, Ukhruj alayhin, could you come out to them, please? Is that going to be him? Is that him? Wait, is he coming? Is that the one? And so they're all just talking among each other, and he comes into the room. And here's the sequence of events. فَلَمَّا رَأَيْنَهُ, then finally when they saw him, finally suggests also that Yusuf alayhi salam was in some far corner of the house, staying as far away as possible, and لَمَّا suggested تَرَاخِي. So eventually when he did reluctantly show up in the room with these dozens of women or whatever they were, all leaned back on their couches. And by the way, when they come dressed up. It's a party, right? And they're not dressed up like Islamically with hijabs, with embroidery on them. You have to understand, they're provocatively dressed. They're basically inappropriately dressed, elite women. That are sitting, and when they sit, Allah is mentioning that she gave them something, you know, sikkin, some have interpreted as a, you know, not the knife, but something to calm them down. But the more plausible meaning is literally a knife, right? Because the cutting is coming anyway. But you can't, it's not beyond imagination to think that when they were called in, they drink wine, they get drunk a little bit, they get relaxed a little bit, now they're sitting back, and she purposely gave them a couch to lean back on, and then she's given them a sharp knife. Now the thing is, common sense, when you have a sharp, you're handling a sharp knife and you're cutting something, how should you be sitting? You should be sitting upright and cutting it. Also, you have to lean in on it. But they're already in a reckless position, they're kind of drunk, they've got this knife, and they're chilling, cutting the fruit like this, and then she says, could you come out over here? And so their eyes are where? At the door, where he's going to come from. فَلَمَّا رَأَيْنَا, when they finally saw him, أَكْبَرْنَهُ. Akbara in Arabic means to think someone, to assume someone to be great. The big English word would be to aggrandize. But simply speaking, to just be wowed by somebody. When he walked in, they were like, whoa. Mm-hmm. And they're just looking at him like wowed, and that's captured inside Akbarna. Akbarna doesn't mean they said takbir. That's not what that means. They thought he was amazing. They thought he was great. Wow, that's him? I could see what. And their eyes are fixated on him. And while they're fixated on him, because they're looking at him and they think he's amazing, when you see something amazing, your eyes get fixated on it, and they don't exactly believe in, you know, lower your eyes. Like they should lower their eyes, the Quran says. That's believing women. They're no second glance, there's one glance all the way. So they're staring away while they got a knife, they're leaned back, and then some of these women accidentally did what? They cut their hand. And when they sliced, now they sliced their hand. Now, I'm not saying all of them sliced their hand. Now, the way that maybe the version you might have heard, I don't know, the way that this has been explained may have been, he walked in and they were like, oh, he's so great! Like, that's not what happened. That doesn't make any sense. Why would somebody, or ladies, on three, one, two, slice. Like they didn't in unison cut their hands. It seems some of them, it doesn't even suggest that all of them, but enough of them cut their hand. قَطَّعْنَا أَيْدِيَهُنَّ. Now, when they cut their hand, who's the only servant in the room? Yusuf alayhi salam. And the job of a servant, if a guest is to be served, the servant will provide. And if he's the servant in the room and a guest gets cut, what's he going to do as a servant? He's going to go bandage. He's going to say, are you okay? Oh, I'm sorry. So now one or two of these, or three or four of these ladies are getting attention from who? Yusuf, he doesn't know that they're gawking at him, or they're staring at him, or they're like, oh, ho, ho. Like, they're not, he doesn't know any of this. He doesn't know that this is akbarnahu. But as he comes and he's attending to the guests that have cut themselves, then some of these women start being inappropriate. Like, they start giggling, or they start trying to touch him, or something like that. And he starts, you know, just backing away. And then you see he's now surrounded by women that want his attention, and they're all inappropriate, and they already think that he's great, and now he came close for a different reason, because he's a servant, and now they're all over him, and they're treating him literally like an object, and he's getting uncomfortable by this, because he's who he is. So in the middle of all of that, you find, and they said, now the women said, Hasha lillah. Hasha lillah could literally mean God forbid. God forbid. But this is actually, you find in this ayah, the blasphemous nature of these women. like, oh God. This is kind of like the, oh God. Now you're using God's name in vain for something filthy, isn't it? That's one meaning of hasha lillah. Oh my God. That's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it, you can turn it into a verb, not kalam insha'i, but actually khabari. Hasha lillah. Hasha lillah means someone who tries to protect themselves, like saying subhanallah, someone who has reverence for God and is guarding themselves. So they're saying, wow, he's guarding himself for God? Oh, he's so righteous. Look at him. He's so spiritual. He doesn't want me to touch him. And they're entertained by this. You know, like, you know when you're playing with a kid and the kid is getting shy? Look at how shy he gets. Like, it's a toy for them to play with. And they're even saying, oh, he gets disturbed by it, huh? Huh. Hasha lillah. Ma hadha bashar. And they all know they came out looking good and provocative or whatever. And maybe some of you have mentioned their intention for coming out looking like that may have been if they see the servant, and if they're hoping the servant looks at them and stares at them, they'll let the lady of the house know, by the way, you're in love with him, but he seems like he's in love with me. Look at the attention he's giving me. But that's not happening. He's not giving a single woman a glance. He's not giving, even though they're like all over him and he's trying to save himself, he's not acting like a man would to even look at a single woman. He's not doing that. So what's the words that come out of their mouth? Ma hadha basharan. This isn't a man. This isn't just any man. This is not a mortal being. This is not a regular guy. Basically, basharan here, basically, this is not a regular guy. Because a regular guy would have loved this kind of attention. He would have loved it. Now one of the classical ways of looking at the same phrasing is he walked in, they said, how great. This is not a man, this is some kind of angel. And there's even some interpretations that light was coming out of him and it was shining onto the walls and there was this angelic presence, because they're going to say, ma hadha basharan in hadha illa malakun kareem. This is nothing but a gracious angel. There's nothing but a gracious angel. So it was so beautiful that he was described as an angel. And then we started having a classical discussion about, are human beings better or are angels better? Or are angels more beautiful than human beings? Is that why they say, listen, we don't engage in the comparison between human beings and angels because some crazy ladies use the word angels. Like, this isn't a prophet talking. This isn't some righteous person who knows about Allah and the angel. These are dirty women talking. Right? So that conversation is irrelevant. We're trying to extrapolate a discussion out of something where it doesn't belong. We have to understand their perspective. Their perspective. We keep thinking, well, Allah mentioned angels here. The angel here. So is he saying that they know what angels look like or what they believed about? Stop all that. Put that on hold for a second. I'm going to give you what some might consider a deviant interpretation, but there's nothing deviant about it because it doesn't actually change our awe and our reverence for Quran and Sunnah, and it actually makes this far more understandable as far as I'm concerned. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Ma hadha basharan. This isn't just a guy. He's not just, because look at how he's, oh my, God forbid, huh? God forbid you don't want to be touched. Wow, this isn't just some regular guy. In hadha illa malakun kareem. This is nothing but a gracious, noble angel. Look at this noble angel over here. Now they're saying noble angel because they can see his innocence. They can see his disturbance. They can see how bothered he is by this shameless environment. These are women that are used to doing this kind of thing. They're used to being in this kind of environment, and they know how men respond to that environment. They've been in that before. So they've been around hundreds of men, if not thousands. Servants or otherwise. So they know what these environments are like and what men are like. It's like they're in the elite club scene. You know what I'm saying? And now all of a sudden they see a man who's so good looking. And they've already heard she's crazy about him. Now they see why. Because he's remarkably good looking. But he's also this innocent, you know, decent character who's not even giving them any attention. And here's the problem. When these women are dying for attention, and he won't even give them an ounce of attention, it makes them want to get his attention even more. It drives them even crazier. So now they're like, oh, this is some kind of angel, huh? Wow. Not even interested? I can't wait to destroy his innocence. I can't wait to take his innocence. So they're just going nuts at this point in this scene. Now some of them have cut their hands. Maybe, I don't know, this is completely conjecture. It could be that you know, some other women, that when he was bandaging one or two, I have a cut too. You know, so he could come and give them attention. And before you know it, things are getting out of hand. Things are just getting really out of control. And as this entire scene is playing out, they don't realize this was exactly what the minister's wife was hoping for. She was hoping that they'd lose their minds when they see him. She was hoping for that. Why? They've got her pushed in a corner. In the corner where she looks like she's crazy for wanting a servant boy. They've got her pushed in a corner because her scandal got out. And they all got something on her. Now, there's a couple of things. One, she's going to show them why when he wouldn't give in to her. Because the word got out that he didn't give in to her. Man, a servant boy rejected her? And they're thinking maybe, man, if it was me, he would never be able to resist. Right? So they've got this pride also. That's been crushed now because he's not giving anybody attention. And she's like, oh, you thought you were better than me, huh? How well did you score with him? How far did you get? Couldn't get very far with him, could you? So that's one. But there's a bigger agenda at play. The same thing they were talking to her about, how she lost control and she fell in love with him and she can't get enough of him and she wants to be all over him. Guess who's trying to be all over him now? These women. So now basically she's put them in a corner saying, you want to talk about me? This is going to be said about you too. You want a scandal about me? You in it with me now, sister. We're together. So, you know, in dirty politics, if one politician's got dirt on you, the only way to get to be safe is what? You got dirt on them. And now we're both safe with each other because I know you'll never come after me because you know if you come after me, I'll be coming after you with what I got. You see what I'm saying? So she responded to her makr with this makr, this scheme. And now she's got evidence on them. They've got their hands cut. The story's going to be, you know, she can spread that story. She's got something on them. So basically at this point, they're all stuck with each other. And she can speak freely now. She doesn't have to be worried about the scandal anymore. She doesn't have to be worried about the embarrassment of what she felt because it's almost as if she's actually in a better position. She's like, I held out for a lot of years. Y'all couldn't take 5 minutes. Look at you. You know, all of you couldn't handle it. See the kind of control I have? So she's in a twisted world. She's in a morally superior position for holding out as long as she did. And I live with him. And look at the control I showed. Right? So that's how she's painting this for herself. So in the next ayah, which I'm going to pause here because I want you to understand the next ayah separately. I want your minds to reset for tomorrow, inshallah. And to look at now what she's going to say now that the cat's out of the bag. Right now it's known, okay, this is, you know what? The rumor's true. That is what happened. And this is also true what just happened with all you women. And now Yusuf alayhi salam is just, what am I caught in? He's caught in a crossfire between the minister's wife and all these other women who are trying to one-up each other, and he's the pawn being played with. He's the pawn being played with. But now it's become a matter of pride for her, right? But what her intentions are now going to come out in the open, and she's going to say, well, I couldn't say much before, but now that I have you on the hook, just like you thought you had me on the hook, now I can speak my mind. And that's what she's going to do in ayah number, what we're going to find, she's going to respond to them in ayah number 32. And hopefully tomorrow, if not tomorrow, the day after, inshallah, we're also going to look at ayah number 33, which is Yusuf's response to all of this. Like he's going to have to deal with the situation too. So that's going to be his response. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.